moment like this. Some people wait a lifetime. Oh, so nice. Oh, that was perfect with the song. You want to dance? No? Okay. Thank you for that, Hannah, for that song. How are you guys doing? Good? Everybody's got the coffee going. I need all of you to take out your phones if you could, like your cell phones, your mobile devices, because I want you to do something really fast. I'm going to go through 95 slides in 30 minutes. I'm not expecting any of you to take notes on them. So what I want you to do is take a picture of this slide. This will take you to SlideShare where you can download the deck in its entirety so that you can have it and you can follow along with it. Now, if you just enter this into your mobile browser, make sure you put the HTTP because Google will then ask you, I have no idea what Bitly is, okay? So everybody got that? And those of you who don't have a camera on your phone, you need to go to a different session. So I can't help you there. Talked about me. We're a venture capital firm. This presentation is definitely based off of all the research we do through due diligence of software companies. We look at thousands of software companies every year, and through that we get to see thousands of different data points on how software companies grow, how they market, how they build products. And this is also based off of my time at ExactTarget, where we did a ton of research around consumer behavior and how they were using email and how the world was changing and all that crap. So this is a presentation that has been built over the past 4 years, and it's what marketing needs to do ultimately to survive. Because marketing has to understand change, and you are pretty much the spearhead of change in any organization, in my opinion. Because technological advancements in general are getting faster, things are changing, our roles are changing. VP of marketing now, marketing leader now, is way different than a marketing leader was 10 years ago, even 5 years ago, especially in software, which is where I come from. So in order for us to truly understand that, I actually don't like talking about change that much. Who's familiar with Louis C.K.? And if you're not, that's really the only thing you should take away from this presentation, honestly. You can go outside and just YouTube Louis C.K. So I got about a 2-minute video clip for you guys to understand change.
Because when I read things like the foundations of capitalism are shattering, I'm like, maybe we need that. Maybe we need some time where we're walking around with a donkey with pots clanging on the sides.
You think that would just bring us back to reality?
Yeah, because everything is amazing right now and nobody's happy. Like, in my lifetime, the changes in the world have been incredible. When I was a kid, we had a rotary phone. We had a phone that you had to stand next to, and you had to dial it.
Yes.
Do you realize how primitive? You're making sparks in a phone, and you actually would hate people with zeros in their numbers because it was more like, oh, this guy's got 2 zeros. Screw that guy. Why do I want to? And then if they called and you weren't home, the phone would just ring lonely by itself. And then if you wanted money, you had to go in the bank for when it was open for like 3 hours. You had to stand in line, write yourself a check like an idiot. And then when you ran out of money, you'd just go, well, I can't do any more things now.
Right.
I can't do any more
things.
That's
it, yeah.
That was it. And even if you had a credit card, the guy would go, ugh, and he'd bring out this whole chunk, and he'd write.
Yeah.
He'd have to call the president to see if you had any money. And
it's all true, kids. You had to call the president, yeah. It was ridiculous.
Yes.
Do you feel that we now, in the 21st century, we take technology for granted?
Well, yeah, because now we live in an amazing, amazing world, and it's wasted on the crappiest generation of just spoiled idiots that don't care, because this is what people are like now. They got their phone, and they're like, ugh, it won't. Give it a second. It's going to space. Can you give it a second to get back from space? Is the speed of light too slow for you? I was on an airplane, and there was internet, high-speed internet on the airplane. That's the newest thing that I know exists. And I'm sitting on the plane, and they go, open up your laptop, you can go on the internet. And it's fast, and I'm watching YouTube clips. I'm in an airplane. And then it breaks down. And they apologize, the internet's not working. The guy next to me goes, this is bull. Like, how quickly the world owes him something.
Yes.
He knew existed only 10 seconds ago.
Right.
Pokemon Go, anyone? Anybody feel like that? Pretty much all of you.
I feel like that on a daily basis, especially when I get emails from people on why aren't we doing something on Pokemon Go, right? Honestly. And so when we're trying to understand change, and Louis C.K. says it best, it's important from a marketing perspective to understand why this is happening. So I have three trends and what I believe is truly changing the way we're doing business. And number one is mobility. Who uses their phone for their alarm clock? Does everybody see this? This is like 90%. Who gets pissed when somebody's ringtone is their alarm tone? Have you ever experienced that on a bus or public transport? If you want to know about mobility changing, that's it. You're pissed that somebody has a ringtone that wakes you up every morning, right? And the world is incredible. Hours of time being spent on average on phones. We all know this, right? But the thing that I take away the most when it comes to customer experience is that it's seamless. Mobility is seamless. So you've all heard of Jay Baer, right? That guy. So let's say I'm walking with my wife with my six-month-old, and I'm like, you know what? I really want to understand how to hug my haters. I'm going to buy Jay Baer's book. And I get on my Amazon app while walking along Newburyport, where I live on the North Shore, and I order Jay's book within a couple seconds using the Amazon app. Or I want to up my shoe game because Andy and Jay also had awesome shoes. I go on Zappos to look for Nikes that I want to buy to up my shoe game. When do those get delivered? Pretty much 12 hours. Or within 3 hours if you're in Boston proper. Or I want to book a flight using Kayak. Everything is seamless. It's easy to use. The design is great. And if you don't think this affects the way people buy your product or service, you are missing the point. If I can buy Jay Baer's book in 5 minutes and I can't click your phone number on your website to call you, you've got a problem. And we could talk about content marketing all day long, but if the mobile experience of what you're doing is broken, it doesn't matter how great your content is. So mobility is completely changing the way we interact as a world. And it's also matured. I think that from a technology perspective, we all have great phones. The one thing that hasn't matured is internet usage. There's still a massive amount of people in the world that don't have internet, which is why you see things like weather balloons and drones that Facebook's like secretly developing. They're gonna probably kill us all in the future. And you know, they want to take internet to the people. Why do they want to take internet to the majority of the population? Because they can sell it, right? And what does that mean for Google and Facebook? Money, right? So the second trend is whoever owns the audience owns the market. I think we do a disservice as marketers, as owners, founders, CEOs, if we don't look at the core tech companies and their ability to disrupt what we do when they want to. I just don't think we spend enough time talking about Walmart buying Jet for an ungodly amount of money. But why did Walmart buy Jet? Because Amazon is eating them alive. From a transportation, everything. So when we're talking about large cap companies, they have one thing that most of us don't have. And what is that? Money. A lot of money, right? Google's cash on hand as of June 30th was what? Does anybody want to guess? And what does cash on hand mean? It's in the bank. Right? Anybody want to guess? $78 billion in cash. Web traffic also dropped 40% when Google had a 5-minute outage. Their ability to own an audience is unbelievable, and they've made 181 acquisitions as of April 16, 2016. Salesforce is the same way. Microsoft, all these major companies like Amazon can have the ability to disrupt multiple type of industries because they have the money to. And it's important for us as marketers to be able to track that and understand that. R&D spending, Amazon spent $13.3 billion on R&D last year. Alexa came out of that, which is awesome. Unfortunately, also the Amazon Fire phone came out that they were trying to sell for $1 for a lot of reasons because it was a crap product. But they're investing constantly. And one of those things is machines, which I think are extremely important to understanding any trend. And artificial intelligence, and that's basically not Microsoft's AI bot, if you've seen that, which started tweeting racist tweets. Sorry, Microsoft. Everybody looked at it and we were like, oh, Microsoft built it. Okay, anyway. AlphaGo, of course, Google, Betterment. Who's familiar with Betterment? Write it down if you're not, next to Louis C.K., the notes that you're taking, the most important notes of this presentation. What I did in 30 seconds on Betterment took my financial planner 3 months to do. And it's completely changing the way a lot of millennials are investing their money, hard-earned money. Well, most millennials, hard-earned money, right? It's completely changing the way the financial services organizations are looking at technology. X.AI, who uses X.AI in here? It's brilliant, and I'll talk about it later. Personal assistant that schedule meetings for you. If you get an email from Amy or Andrew Ingram, it's not a real person, it's a robot, right? They get X. If you talk to anybody at X.AI, they'll get flowers sent to the office for Amy. And Amy's not a person, it's not a human being. But it is so good at what it does that it's completely changing that one thing that's a pain in the ass for most of us, and that's scheduling meetings, right? And then you have narrative science, this is one of my favorite ones, and they basically generate news stories, industry reports, headlines, and more at scale without human authoring or editing. Forbes did a pilot with them last year where they took all of their, basically, writers of their analyst team for earnings reports, laid them off or moved them into a different part of Forbes, and sent in data, sent in Excel files to Narrative Science, and Narrative Science wrote the earnings reports without editing, and Forbes published them. If you go to Forbes and type in Narrative Science, there's a ton of articles that the program wrote without editing. Now, are they gonna create poetry? No, but it's important to note that this is the very beginning of something great, in my opinion, or deadly, when Terminator comes back, right? So this stat is made up by me, so take it with you, what you will. No data was behind this at all. 70% of your job will be automated by 2020. I do think that a lot of things that we do as marketers will be automated, but have no fear, marketing doesn't survive, it evolves. I think that we have to evolve. I think from a communications perspective, we have to evolve. So the trends that we have to, these are the trends disrupting. But now let's talk about how we evolve. And number one is embracing the 5 P's of marketing survival. It's a great copywriting on my part. So there's 5 that I think marketers don't, or leaders in general, don't focus enough on. And it goes in order: principles, process, people, programs, and performance. And I think that you have to look at this quarterly or yearly, if not quarterly, honestly, in terms of how fast the world is changing. Principles are, what are your fundamental beliefs and objectives of your team that then tie into the mission, vision, and values of your company, right? The process is, how does your team operate and optimize for product, pricing, promotions, and channels? This is very software centric, but you get my point. So you have great people, you have the process, or you have the, then you have the people. Do you have the right people? Hire for aptitude, attitude, and agility. Your company's most valuable, this is one of my favorite tweets of all time. Thank you, William. I have no idea who you are, but it was great. Your company's most valuable resource is people giving a shit. And it's really true. If you go to any great soft, like this user conference, any software user conference, any type of conference where the customers are there and they love the product and they love the brand, that sells itself. And your people help you sell that as well. Programs. How do you deliver programs that uncover new sources of revenue growth? And then underlining all of it is performance. Do you have the system in place to track and evolve what you're doing? I think the evolution, the idea of continuous rapid improvement is why marketing will survive. You have to continuously and rapidly improve upon what you're doing using data to do that. Number two is your experience matters. The experience, I talked about it with the Amazon app, the experience is everything. If you get the experience right, your product or service will sell itself. If I have a hard time calling your office and talking to somebody that doesn't care what I want or why I'm calling, that's a broken part of the experience. And it's going to affect everything else. Everything else. I was talking to the SVP of customer experience yesterday for TD Bank, Wendy Arnott, and she was talking about how if she calls the customer service department and gets a bad rep, it affects every single point along the journey for TD Bank, no matter if it has anything to do with the customer service department or not, because that was the initial point of contact and was terrible. But if you get it right, the product will sell itself and your customers will sell it for you. Betterment's a great example. It's easy to use. It's simple. It delivers value. X.AI is another example, which I talked about before. Just type in X.AI in Twitter search and just look to see what people are saying. And they use that for collateral. They use it on their website. They have a stream of people, what people are saying. Now, they don't put negative ones on there, so I don't know. They might be filtering a little bit, which is okay. But they got the product right. They got the experience right, and it's starting to sell itself. Unfortunately, 1% of us actually deliver a great customer experience. And I think we all know that because it's really, really hard to do. I don't care if you're Delta or you're a small software company. It's really hard to deliver a great customer service experience from end to end. But it's important that you understand the customer journey. UserTesting.com, portfolio company of ours, a great company to use in terms of mapping how somebody is using your product or service. UserTesting.com. It's a great service. They have panels of people using apps and websites and giving feedback on how, what's broken, or why is that button there, or who's that, the face of that person on your homepage, that type of stuff. Because every single point along the customer journey is important, from awareness to advocacy. And just to give you an idea of how difficult this is Delta's customer journey. Is this all handled by marketing? No. Why not? Because it's a huge company. But if you think of small companies or your companies, does marketing handle every point of the entire customer lifecycle? No. But you guys have to be evangelists within the company to make sure that it's the best experience possible. ExactTarget had a phrase internally called surprise and delight, which is very humble pie Indiana. However, but that was the whole point. How do you surprise and delight people no matter what they're doing or how they're doing it? Because we want everyone to be involved in our brand. Number three is it's not content marketing, it's thought leadership. The term content marketing in general, I'm fine with. I think content marketing is product marketing, if you're talking from a software perspective. I think thought leadership is research and data and stuff that Andy was talking about. So I'm gonna give you four different types that we actually did at ExactTarget that really drove a ton of leads, top of the funnel leads, as well as really valuable MQLs or SALs for the sales team. But the thing important to know is thought leadership is not about you, it starts and ends with your customer. I think content marketing is important because you need middle of the funnel content. You need to sell people on your product or service. You need to be able to sell why you are better than your competitors. But real thought leadership is about the customer. So when we talk about the four types of thought leadership, this is what we built within ExactTarget: experiential, consumer, peer, and benchmark. And this was over the course of, we had a team of 12 out of Indianapolis that was running content for six countries, basically top of the funnel demand gen for six countries. And this is over the course of 2 years testing what we figured out would work. So experiential thought leadership is actually understanding your customer's customer or the buyer's journey. So what we did, and I gotta give credit to Jeff Roars, who's now the CMO at Yext in New York, this was his idea. We actually got salespeople in a room and said, hey, we have a list of 100 retail stores or retailers that's on our, like the top 100 fastest growing retailers or whatever the hell the list we use. We want to target them. We have 80 on the list that's not customers. So what we did was we bought gift cards for all these salespeople and said, we want you to go shopping. We created a mobile checklist for them to keep track of in-person shopping. Like, was there a newsletter sign up at point of purchase? Did the did they ask for your email for the, I was at that brewery way too long. Wherever you slide your damn credit card, right? Not the chunk chunk that Louis C.K. was talking about, but the point of purchase display where they're asking for your email. Was the employee nice, right? All those things we were tracking, and then we went on their website, signed up, and started tracking over 90 days what the experience was like. So if I went into Tiffany's and I bought a necklace And then I went online and used my email address and bought something else. Were they connecting those 2 points? Out of the 100 retailers, how many do you think were connecting the 2 data sources? Just guess. 2. Tiffany's and Dollar Store. At the time, so this was like 2013. And it helped, and we basically took all this data in. The salespeople were excited because they were involved in the process, and we delivered report cards to each of these CMOs via email as well as direct mail, and also to their VPs to say, hey, here's your report card on your journey of 5 stores that we did and your online presence. By the way, here's also the report card of your competitors that we also tracked. That type of content is extremely powerful because it's about them. We're trying to understand their scenario, not something like top 10 ways you can get better retail emails, blah, 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 right? Everybody does that. Everyone. The only thing that makes you different is the data that you create and you own. And experiential data was one part of that. We also did consumer thought leadership. So it was, hey, we're entering the Japanese market. This is the more expensive side of it, by the way. We're going to go interview or survey 2,000 Japanese consumers on how they use their mobile phones because we had an SMS product. We want to survey Japanese consumers on how they care about emails via or receipts via email. And we produce those reports. 80% of all of our PR for ExactTarget was from our content, from thought leadership. And we were a public company. 80% of all mentions in media was because of thought leadership. Because when I call a reporter at TechCrunch, they care about a data point, not that ExactTarget launched a new email service. Like, who cares that you launched a product? Who cares that you... I think I was talking to Jeff earlier, and he showed me a PR release that he had just received where a company had announced that they hired a PR firm, and that was their release. And I wanted to die. Like, I almost threw up on myself. Like, it seriously pisses me off because they are wasting money, and they are doing bad PR and communications. Anyway, I'm off my soapbox. Consumer thought leadership, actually understanding the trends of the consumer and why we're doing what we're doing. Peer thought leadership is even more important, where you're actually surveying or aggregating like Andy talked about, because I was like cheering in the background for Andy because it was everything I believe in that he talked about. Actually understanding what your peers are doing. So we went and surveyed, and they still do them today at Salesforce, State of Marketing, State of Analytics, State of Sales, where they're surveying peers saying, what are you gonna spend your money on? How are you gonna spend your money? And that performed extremely well for us. And then the last one, which we didn't do very well at ExactTarget, was benchmarking. You have data. I don't care what you do, and it's unique to you. For ExactTarget, it would have been 60% of the 60 billion emails we send are opened at 8 a.m., right? That type of benchmarking and actually producing data that differentiates you from the competitors. And that's true brand-building thought leadership. Of course, you need the other side of content marketing, I think, which is more tactical, but the idea of brand-building thought leadership is that you are producing content that nobody else has because you spent time and energy understanding what your customer wants and needs. And it's not that they need your software or product, it's that they want to try to understand how to do their job better. And that's true thought leadership. I think ExactTarget did it really well. I think there's a lot of companies that do it really well. There's a lot of companies, as Andy showed on his graph, that do it poorly because we don't spend enough time and energy on content. Thought leadership is not the sales pitch, it supplements the sell. We did a lot of effort driving thought leadership to the CMO of Nike, of Gap, so that we could sell to the VP of marketing and the user, the email marketer. And that's what thought leadership is all about from a content perspective. All right, 2 more and then I'm done. Die engagement metrics, long live unit economics. This is one thing that I've learned from being in the VC world. I think that marketers don't spend enough time actually understanding the unit economics of their business. And I'll get into a little bit more detail, but this is my favorite quote. I've used it for 5 years. David Walmsley, we must move from numbers keeping score to numbers that drive better actions. I think we keep way too much scores on our Salesforce dashboards, any analytics tool that you're using, trying to keep score and not actually thinking about how that's supposed to be changing. Your goals should be shifting every month because the consumer changes every month. You have to understand the data. So marketing should function like an e-commerce company. If you talk to any great e-commerce company, they are obsessed with every single data point that drives revenue for their business. So engagement metrics are important. I think it's important to understand time on site, bounce rate, blah, 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 visits. But they're secondary, in my opinion, to the unit economics of a business, which, in my opinion, you must understand better than your CEO. Now, whether you do that or not, I don't know. But I think it's important for marketers to understand. Some unit economics, especially in software, customer acquisition costs, lifetime value of a customer, LCV, payback period, customer retention. If you drive a ton of leads into your business and you sell a ton of them and everybody's happy and you're like, yeah, we hit quarterly earnings, blah, 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 quarterly reporting. And 60% of those customers churn within 2 months, whose fault is that? Everyone's. It's not only marketing's job to drive leads via content or anything else that you're doing. It's also your job to understand the health of your business because it's your livelihood. You do it 12 hours a day, sometimes 18 hours a day. You have to understand the unit economics that are driving a business and you will be a better marketer for it. And sales teams and customer success teams and customer service teams will appreciate the fact that you're trying to understand their unit economics of their business units. Unit. Okay, it's important to understand. And I did not understand that until I got to a VC firm where we were doing a ton of due diligence and financial reporting for software companies. So the last one is data cleanse. We talk a lot about marketing stacks and software and automation and X.AI doing meetings and blah, blah, blah. But if your data is crap, none of it's gonna work. And we talk a lot about trends and what's changing and how it's changing. And most of the time when I'm in a business, when I'm doing due diligence for a business or I'm helping the investment team do due diligence, it's the data that's the problem. They try to plug in an automation system and it just breaks because the data is so bad. Or their sales teams all have customer data on Google Sheets. How does that help anyone? It doesn't. So central reporting, but from a trends perspective, we always talk about big data, and I actually love this quote because it actually explains everything that I'm all about, which is kind of confusing, actually, if you read it. big data is like teenage sex. Everyone talks about it. Nobody really knows how to do it. Everyone else is doing it, so everyone claims they are doing it. And I think that's data in general. I hate the term big data. I think it's just data. I think you have to manage it the right way. There's going to be a huge increase in data, for sure. And 70% of us fail miserably at managing data. You are a great marketer if your data is being cleansed on a monthly basis, if not weekly, honestly. Because your survival is your ability to sell the people that you're getting in the door, not getting them in the door. It's very important to understand. I think data cleanse is important. So how does marketing officially clean data? Should be your top priority. Get your team off of spreadsheets, please, for the sake of everything in life. Quit using spreadsheets. Get one system of record for the entire company. Good luck with that. It's going to be a pain in the ass. Process. Sales teams needs processes. Marketing team needs processes. It's part of that 5 P's that I've talked about earlier. Your ability to manage data the right way makes an UberFlip an unbelievable tool to use. Because you're producing content and you're managing that content, you actually understand what's happening with that content after the fact. It's really, really, really important. And one last thing, you're not growth hackers or marketers, founders or the CEO, digital savants, or social ninjas. I'm sorry if anybody uses the term ninja, other than Baker Ninja, who I met yesterday, which is an awesome company idea, honestly. Don't put ninja in your LinkedIn profile ever, please. We hired 100 people last year for our portfolio, and we will not even call you if you have ninja in your profile. So you're none of these. Honestly, you're role at a company as an experienced maker and manager. The only thing that makes you relevant in your job, I don't care what you do, is the experience the customer has with your brand. It's the only thing that makes you relevant. So your ability to understand the trends and the disruptions that are happening in the market, and your ability to understand what a consumer is doing, how they are doing it, how they buy your product, why they didn't buy your product, is extremely important to your success and survival as a marketer. So understanding the customer service or customer experience is top priority overall, and the ability to create content around that is your number one goal. Thank you. I appreciate it.